the concept of edge observability, people ask all the time, you know, what is edge? Does that mean it's a kind of a physical edge location? And really not necessarily. I mean, if we talked about the early days of AWS and Azure, and again, you know, I was a developer on the Azure team over 10 years ago, you know, this concept of taking all raw data and storing it into some massive cloud repository first, and then starting to analyze that data, that really needed to be improved upon. And we saw the improvement. We saw the improvement with technologies like Kafka, like Kinesis, you know, the ability to use some of these more stream processing solutions. And really, when we think about edge, we just think about the next iteration of, you know, you have your data stored in some sort of S3 bucket or blob storage or equivalent, and then you have your data being processed still in the cloud using these stream processing layers. And then we really look at edge as the next iteration. You know, how are you starting to analyze your data as it's being created, where it's being created? And we believe that at the data volumes that are being created today, that is the only approach, right? You know, we are very quickly getting to the point where it is just not feasible at today's data volumes to try to take all that raw data and put it into a cloud repository first before you start to analyze it. And, you know, stream processing was a half step in the right direction, and we believe edge is another three steps in the right direction. So we're pretty excited about kind of being on the forefront of leading that charge and saying, you know, we want to be extremely upstream where that data is being created, and that gives a cascading amount of benefits all the way down the line. But I'd love to hear your take as well.
I mean, I think you have to sort of start with what is edge, right? It's a sort of overloaded term, and it means a lot of things. To me, edge is sort of symbolic of how things are, everything's distributed these days, right? You know, how you even work, right? Teams are fully distributed, right? You know, to your point, that everything has to be in one place to be processed, I think that's gone, right? You had to do that for technological reasons, which, you know, we can get into. But now there's so much advancement in terms of compute power in a fully distributed way. You're going to see companies like us take advantage of that.
Yeah, and I think, you know, 10 years ago, or maybe even 5 years ago, you were seeing these teams and they had megabytes or maybe even gigabytes of data. You know, some of our customers today are analyzing petabytes and petabytes of data that they're creating every day. And, you know, these concepts apply to pretty much any organization creating more than a terabyte of data. So I think, you know, you're absolutely right, which is the old way of doing things is fantastic in theory. But at, you know, today's data volumes and various different microservices and all the high cardinality data sets, it's just not feasible anymore to do it the old way. So Tim, what do you see as like the biggest challenge related to observability today?
I mean, I think obviously the data volume we touched on, it's just hard to, you know, process terabytes or petabytes a day and sort of connect the dots in the way that's necessary, right? People traditionally think of observability as being logs, metrics, and traces. I mean, just building traces across terabytes of data per day is just so hard, right? And then being able to sort of traverse between logs and metrics and logs to tracing and metrics to tracing and sort of all sort of combinations of that is just really, really hard, again, because of the volume piece. And so I think the idea that you could push it down to the edge and you know, get lower latency, obviously, process less data, sort of do automatic anomaly detection in the agents in the way that we're doing with Edge Delta is just a really novel approach to solve some of these really challenging observability problems.
Yeah, I think, you know, one of the biggest challenges that I see is a lot of the developers, they're having to constantly fight these internal battles of, can I have access to my logs? Can I have access to my metrics? Can I have access to my traces? You know, can I turn on debug? Can I look at all the pre-production environments? A lot of times when you're looking at these mission critical systems, the mission critical systems, it's really easy for you to make the argument that you should be looking at that data. For, you know, pre-production services, a lot of times they can be looked at as like a second-class citizen. And for developers, that can make it really challenging where they feel like, you know, they don't get access to all the real-time visibility and the tools that they need to be able to release at a cadence that's required today to be able to be competitive. So, you know, I'd love your take on it as well. You know, what are you seeing across the industry with various different developers and how they get access to the logs, metrics, and traces?
Yeah, I mean, it's obviously very challenging because you're typically gluing together a number of services on top of the fact that the data is humongous. I think also it's hard to understand even what to look for, right, when something goes wrong. And so these challenges, I think, will be there for quite some time. People eventually will figure it out. Having a solution though like Edge Delta, I think really, really helps, right? This idea that you can cut down the volume, the idea that you can detect anomalies, you know, right at the source of the data being produced, I think it's gonna help out developers a ton. So I think layering Edge Delta on top of observability, or even using Edge Delta for observability on its own, really is gonna help the developer community.
Yeah, I mean, I think that's what we're about, right? Is how do we give access to all of the data across all of the various different teams in the organization? You know, this whole concept of, you know, this data is worth it to look at and to visualize and to understand and to analyze and to derive insights from, and these other data sets don't quite meet the minimum threshold or the bar to be able to, you know, effectively be admitted into these various different visibility tools. That, as an engineer, pains me, right? As an engineer, I want everyone to be able to have access to all that data. And, you know, fundamentally, if you think about it logically, we cannot bend the laws of physics, right? You have to go upstream. You have to go closer to where the data is being created. And then you can pre-process and analyze and drive those insights of that data without having to have the kind of the financial and technical constraints that the traditional centralized solutions have. So it's, you know, that's really what we want to try to accomplish, is to give access to that data, and we're pretty excited about our approach.
Yeah, when you think about logs, metrics, and traces, I think metrics and traces are mostly structured in terms of how they're collected, right? Logs, obviously, I think sort of dominates in terms of how people consume the data. I think people disproportionately look at more logs than, say, metrics and traces. And so I think as a developer, as you're hitting on earlier, typically what you do is you sort of log everything. And then you just store everything for safekeeping, and it helps you sleep better at night. And you don't necessarily even know why you're keeping all that data. It's just having it there is just, it's comforting somehow. And that's why I'm so excited about what we're doing here at Edge Delta, is because it sort of solves that problem for you in the other direction, right? It helps you understand what you should be looking at, which I think, you know, going back to the earlier question, is possibly one of the hardest problems for a developer.
You should have access to all your raw data. Now, should you put all that raw data in a really hot, searchable, performant data store? Maybe, maybe not. And I think to your point, when you look at the statistics around how much of this raw data is actually searched, it's a mind-blowingly small percentage of that data. And so fundamentally, if we believe that you can be very proactive and upfront as the data is being created, you know, some of your data can go into, you know, if we're talking about open source solutions, let's say some of your data goes into Elastic, some of your data goes into Influx, you know, then some of your data goes into Snowflake, some of your data goes into S3. If we look at a lot of the various different data sets, all your raw data being in S3 and yet some derived insights being in Elastic or Influx, that might actually be the right approach. We just don't fundamentally believe that all of your data should exist in Influx, and all of your data should exist in Elastic, and also another copy should exist in S3, and another copy should exist in Splunk, and another copy exists in Datadog. You know, fundamentally, as we see this modularization of observability, the appropriate data sets should live in the appropriate locations. But you as a developer shouldn't have to manage that, right? You shouldn't have to sit there and say, okay, well, this specific data set, or, you know, if data equals prod, go into Splunk. If data equals test or staging, go into S3. You shouldn't have to manually pick those things. It should really be that all the data can be pre-processed and all the insights can live everywhere, just not necessarily in raw format.
Yeah, I mean, we talked earlier about this idea of the new data stack, right? And if I'm a data architect in some enterprise today, I think this idea of having the routing component as a key architectural component in my pipeline is sort of a must-have today, right? I think you absolutely have that. The idea that all data goes to one place is gone, right?
Yep.
You can't do that anymore, right? Like, certainly you have to have the OLAP engine, you have to have the tools that sit on top of it, ELT, ETL, reverse ETL, pre-ETL, all of that. But you still have to collect the data, and it's not always gonna go to one place, right? And so building that solution yourself is really, really hard, and I think that's where solutions like Edge Delta come in.
Yeah, and I think, you know, if we look at the traditional kind of data analytics and ETL space, you know, we've seen that real-time operational data sets across observability, that's a hard problem to solve. And, you know, filtering and sampling and, you know, kind of splitting your data up and routing it to different locations has existed for, you know, many, many years. And what Edge Delta, I think, has done to iterate on that is to say, you know, filtering and sampling isn't enough, right? And to be able to just simply route data to one location, and for that one location to be one size fits all for all your different data sets and all your different use cases, that's also not enough, right? So You know, I think Edge Delta and what we're doing is the ability for you to be able to be proactive and look at those data sets and unpack the various different data sets and look for anomalies and statistical deviations and various different insights out of your data and then appropriately route that to all your downstream systems. That is something that all of our customers and, you know, all the viewers out here should want to be able to do with their data.
Yeah, I've never actually seen that sampling works. Like, I've been in the space for so long and I've seen a lot of things. In practice, you would imagine that it should work, right? But what happens is when you start to like double click in, right, there's a lot of bias that gets introduced by the hashing function that you select. Mm-hmm. And I think a lot of engineers, you know, these days you're just cobbling stuff together very quickly. If you don't spend the time to really sort of study the sort of the distribution of the results that you get from that hashing function, you'll see that the data actually will come out wrong.
Yeah.
Right. I remember at Yahoo, we spent, I think, 2 years studying all flavors of hashing algorithms to find one that actually would give us okay results.
Right.
Right. And the idea that you can sample data and somehow get the data that the results that you want, I think it's just, it's wrong. It's intuitively something that you should pursue, but you know, if you're as old as I am, you'll see that it actually doesn't work. And so what you want to do is actually process the full fidelity data, but actually strip it down to something that's usable.
Yep.
Right. Sampling, I think, is just a totally broken approach.
Yeah. Yeah. I think, you know, we're seeing this across all the various different data sets, right? So, you know, the traditional sampling and filtering, to your point, is very limited. And, you know, I look at it as akin to just neglecting various different data sets. You know, it's something that's been around for a long time, and it's something that has been a pain for many developers and DevOps engineers. And to, again, try to use this one-size-fits-all approach is just...
And if you're throwing out, you know, 90% of the data because you're doing 10% sampling, you're going to miss the anomalies, right? Yeah. You just are, because you're probably doing something like hashing a cookie, right, into different buckets. And the anomalies, in my experience, always show up in the 90% of the data that you threw away.
Yeah. Well, and I think it's also, you know, if you think about the mean time to identify issues versus, you know, to resolve them, you can still do sampling and maybe you can identify some of the issues. But to your point, you know, when you start to try to do a root cause analysis or you're trying to actually resolve or remediate a live production issue, that's when you really need access to all that raw data. That's when you need to say, I wish I wouldn't have filtered or I wish I wouldn't have sampled out 90% of my data sets, because I actually want to get to the core issue and I want to understand if my developers are releasing, you know, daily or weekly or multiple times in a day or hourly, how do I actually get that information and get that insight into how are my downstream systems changing and how can I roll back or how can I remediate some of these production issues that are causing disastrous effects on the business?
Yeah, I think, you know, I'm a fan of simple and talking about things in a very sort of straightforward and easy to consume way. And so the way I talk about Edge Delta with a lot of people, because, you know, I get this question a lot. People hear about the company all the time. And so what I say is like, hey, it does three things really, really well, right? It does anomaly detection at the edge, right? It does a little bit of ML behind the scenes to do that in the agent, right, that you're running on your host, right? And it also allows you to truncate and cut down the amount of data leaving the host through the configurable UI in the cloud, which is great for users because you're sending less data off, and, you know, you can sort of redact it, you can PII mask it, so on and so forth. And a side consequence of that is you're going to have lower cost on some of these cloud logging tools that you use, right? Because everyone charges based on data volume of ingest. And so it's a really great sort of side effect of having less data. And then the third thing that I get really excited about is the idea that I can have one agent running on the host that I can configure in the UI and send data to any number of places. I just think that that's just amazing, right? I wanted to do that forever in my past life. And I achieved it in really hacky ways, right? I would do it and run 10 agents on the host, right? The idea that I can have one agent and send data to any number of places. You know, when I look at that UI that we have that has all the logos of places where it can go, I get really excited. Like, what I do is I sort of count the logos, right? Because we had this problem at Splunk, right? The biggest problem that we had was actually integration, right? And the idea that we make that integration so simple is just an amazing proposition for users.